Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. My name is Rani Singh, and I work at the Getty Research Institute in the Department of Architecture and Contemporary Art. And today is the second installment in the Getty's ongoing Pacific Standard Time LA lecture series, Latin Americanisms. And today we'll be screening two films by Argentine artist Leandro Katz. And we're extremely lucky that Leandro is here with us and that he'll be able to speak about his work later this afternoon. An accomplished artist, filmmaker, and poet, his works stretch across a broad range of media. Over the years, his projects have involved sustained engagements with archival and historical materials across the Americas and have resulted in installations, photography, films, and poetry. Through reflections on historical artifacts and archival absences, his work reveals the micro-histories that exist at the margins of the dominant historical narratives. Paradox, the first film we'll see today, offers a jarring juxtaposition of past and present in Guatemala, composed of alternating video footage of the monumental dragon at the Maya site of Quiguera and the operations of a modern industrial banana plantation. Here, the obstinate duration of the ancient past throws into relief the precarious conditions of the present, underlying the region's dramatic transformation through the modern colonialism of industrial agriculture. Paradox will be followed by Leandro's 1997 film, El Día Que Me Quieras, or The Day You'll Love Me. In this film, Katz dissects a modern myth, investigating the circumstances of Che Guevara's execution in Bolivia in 1967. His search is guided by a haunting photograph of the revolutionary's corpse, an image which leads him to the photographer who made it, as well as archival documents, photographs, and film. Katz's film discovery and arrangement of these sources, alongside his own original footage, reveals how memory and subjectivity, as well as documentation, inform the construction of historical events. And both of these films provide a compelling jumping-off point for this afternoon's lectures and conversation about archive and memory. Welcome to part two of the afternoon for what we're calling Latin Americanisms, a series of conversations hosted in conjunction with the Getty's initiative, Pacific Standard Time, LA. And our series is intended to serve as a space for the Pacific Standard Time exhibition curators, Latin American scholars, and practitioners to enter into a dialogue about current issues, research questions, and curatorial concerns that connect all of our projects. Our goal is for these conversations to respond to the intellectual curiosities and practical needs that arise as the PST initiative develops. We welcome your ideas for future topics, speakers, and formats, and we hope that these events spark ideas and conversations about Latin America that will continue as 2017 approaches. Our conversation today will center on archive and memory in Latin America. Many of the PST exhibitions involve delving into archives of all shapes and sizes, from pristine reading rooms to dusty boxes in someone's garage. For many of us, our projects require traveling throughout the Americas in order to reconstruct archives of social movements, recreate historical performances, and present artist archives. Today's talks will help us think reflexively about how curatorial projects discover, consolidate, and deploy archival materials. As Leandro's film Paradox has just illustrated for us so powerfully, the materials of the past exist both outside of and in intimate proximity to the concerns of the present. In making curatorial choices concerning our work with archives, we're forced to consider the simultaneously palpable and elusive nature of historical materials, our desires to both catalog the archive's contents and maintain its fundamental openness, our efforts to both respect the specificities of historical context and to underline the importance of the past for our present concerns. We're extremely fortunate to be joined by an artist and a scholar who have both thought extensively about the archive and the construction of history and memory. Argentine artist Leandro Katz has had a prolific career that bridges the mediums of film, photography, installation, and poetry. Through projects based on archival materials and extensive research, Katz has investigated the history of archaeology, colonialism, and the pre-Columbian past. In projects such as Paragox, his well-known Catherwood project, and examine legacies of state violence and revolutionary politics in Latin America in works like El Día que Mi Lequeros. His work has been supported by the Guggenheim, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Rockefeller Foundation, among many others. Macarena Gomez Barris is an associate professor of American Studies and Ethnicity and Sociology at the University of Southern California. Her work is broadly concerned with questions of memory, culture, power, and indigeneity in Latin America. Her first book, Where Memory Dwells, Culture and State Violence in Chile, examined visual representations and public manifestations which commemorate histories of state violence, examining the role of such memory work in constituting identities and collective understandings of the past and present. She is currently conducting research on indigenous reactions to neoliberal capitalism in Bolivia, Peru, and Chile with funding from the Fulbright Program. Today's event will include two 30-minute presentations by our speakers, followed by a moderated conversation and a question and answer period. And we then invite you to join us for coffee in the lobby. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Leandro Katz.
Thank you once more. Oh, there you are. It's interesting because I am working on the notion of landscape and memory. And in the process, I seem to have become a kind of archaeologist of myself. And so in reviewing many of my archives, I go back and find things that are in my view, revealing of the direction that the works take later on. And I wanted first to share with you two monologues that come from a film that has hardly circulated for technical and other reasons. I have selected two monologues from a film released in 1994, Mirror on the Moon. And I thought that the monologues themselves enclose personal experiences. So the idea of landscape and memory has to do more with memory of landscape, not as citizenship, but landscape as the markings of a personal and a very intimate development. Landscape, what we see in front of our eyes, seem to sort of like mark different points, at least from my perspective, in which I realize that something has marked me in such a way that I have to return to it. And so I wanted to share these two monologues. If we could project, the first one is we see David Warrilow, the actor David Warrilow, one of the two favorite Beckett's performers, Samuel Beckett's. In 1970, a friend of mine who happened to be the director of the Instituto de Antropología e Historia de Guatemala, allowed me to stay in the archaeologists' huts in the ruins of Tikal. And so I had spent about a month inside Tikal, taking photographs to the point that I had run out of color film. And then the only way to get out of Tikal was by road or by canoe, but I only had infrared film left in the camera. And so these are color infrared photographs of a trip by canoe all the way to southern Guatemala and via Rio Dulce, Lake Izabal, and then on trucks and buses by road all the way to the near the border of Honduras in southern Guatemala, where I knew that Quiriguá was. This is 1970. And infrared film registers greens in a deep magenta color. And so there is this very strange and beautiful color distortion. And I came to the site of Quiriguá, and the site had been abandoned for a long time, and the Motagua River had swollen to the point that the site was practically flooded into a swamp. I was with a Guatemalan friend and an American friend, but they both refused to enter because the moment we would enter, we would be covered by voracious mosquitoes. And they were afraid of malaria. I decided to chance it, and I went into the brush. I found a way to get in. I wanted to go all the way to the end of the site, looking at the stelas and photographing quickly as I was being devoured by huge, black, mean-looking mosquitoes. And I managed to find a path, and this is when I saw the dragon for the first time. And I think this this vision really marked me in such a way. The monument was absolutely covered by deep green moss, beautiful, thick, velvety moss. So what we see here is actually greens. And as you can see, the altar that is in front of the dragon was sunken into the swamp, into the mud. And later on, I realized that Alfred Mosley had done a lot of investigation in the site in 1883. And in 1883, he uncovered and cleaned up the zoomorph P structure, sculpture that I call the dragon, had taken glass negatives, beautiful glass negatives that are now, I think, in London, in the British Museum. And he had made drawings. What you can see, if you compare the more recent photographs that I took with the ones that Alfred Mosley took, you will see the results of erosion, especially on the face. He also made drawings, and this is what I saw. And then later on, I realized the site had been literally abandoned since 1934, when Sylvanus Morley conducted his last expeditions for the Carnegie Institute. As I said, everything was covered with thick moss, and it gave you the impression that it was alive, that it was a living entity because of the green. And in 1974, I was there in 1970, 1971, and in 1974, Robert Scherer went back to do work and cleaned up the structure. In other words, I was there 30 years after the last expedition, or more, 35 years nearly. And I think that that experience really is the one that eventually inspired me to work on the Catherwood project. I am timing myself so that Macarena could have her rightful moment. And well, many of you are familiar with this project, and then I wanted to actually point you to several research projects that I had done. The Catherwood project uses three or four different approaches, holding the original Catherwood engraving published in the Stevens and Catherwood book, holding it up in front of the lens, reproducing carefully the original Catherwood engravings from first editions using very high format cameras. This print, for example, has a complex darkroom process in which a special easel is made so that the top, the engraving, is a contact print, and in absolute darkness is moved to another and larger, and the lower part is a projection print. It all has to be done in absolute darkness. Here I combine the Catherwood engraving. The engravings were made by an engraver based on Catherwood's drawings with the point of view of my photographs, trying to approach as much as possible Catherwood's original point of view. The other approach obviates the Catherwood point of view, but it follows the same perspective. And Catherwood also wanted to incorporate the human figure, and I decided to incorporate the tourist as a kind of presence, a kind of nomadic tribe that appears everywhere. And so the other approach incorporates the presence of tourists. And the next approach is the use of night photography using a complicated technique that required the camera to be set up at sundown while there was still light, and then wait for night to fall, and then start illuminating the structure in sections using an open flash technique, which is, I am holding a flash in front of me, I'm covered with the black cloth, I approach the structure and I fire in order to light that section, and then I move, I light the second section, etc. And sometimes you can see my silhouette there. The sky, you see, the stars are trailing. It takes about 40 minutes to take a photograph such as this one. It takes several firings of the flash to, here is a diagram of how this structure was illuminated. You can see that there are numbers in each of the sections as I move away from the cameras. More times, the flash has to be fired several times in order to get something like this. Here I am working with a friend, an assistant, Tosh Ozawa, who came on during this section of the Catherwood project to help me. He's climbing on the right and I'm climbing on the left. The steps that you see are about the height of a chair, and it takes more than an hour to take this photograph. Sorry. I wanted to make a reference of my transition between the experience of doing the Catherwood project, moving across very militarized borders during the Iran-Contra affairs, during the Salvadorian Ejército de Liberación Nacional struggles. And here we see a map of the trajectory of the two Catherwood expeditions. I don't know if you can see the faintly red markings. And when I was moving between Quiriguá and Copán, I was going through, as I said, military posts, trying to cross over, realizing that on one hand I was interested in the ancient past, but I was continuously being haunted by what was going on in the present. And I went back to New York. I had a former assistant who told me that she was working as an archivist at the Bettman Archive, Photographic Archive, and she invited me to go and look at the files. And I began looking at Latin American files during that period. That was in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s. And this is where I became interested in the way Latin America was being represented. I collected this archival photographs by different press photographers, but what I began doing was to, I began photographing the Ted Koppel report. I don't know if some of you may remember the Nightline Ted Koppel report. Was very involved with the whole crisis in Salvador, and this is what I would take photographs from the TV set, and I made this work during that time. It's our children trying to identify the cadaver of their father. And this is where I found the Freddy Alborta photograph, and eventually began El Día Que Me Quieras, met with Freddy Alborta, who you saw in the documentary, a marvelous man. These are production photographs. We're setting up the light for the interview, and this is his famous photograph. And I'm showing you some slides of production stills. Caterina Borelli, the soundman, Robert Tass, cameraman, Mark Daniels, in the town when we are about to film the procession, and then Mark Daniels filming the red banner scene that you just saw. There's a huge, deep ravine in between where the camera is and the people are, and in order to communicate, we had walkie-talkies, but sometimes it wouldn't work, and so you would have to go down the ravine and up to tell people what to do. But and this is one of the last scenes from El Día Que Me Quieras in the town of Ilabaya. as you know, the El Día Que Me Quieras is based on an essay by John Berger, where he first compares the Alborta photographs with Mantegna and Rembrandt. And I wanted to mention that because of the relationship that it all seems to have. If you can see, this is a map of southern, where you can see at the bottom, I was working in Honduras in Copan. Sorry. And you can see the site of Quirigua nearby. Catherwood actually visited Quirigua by himself. Stevens was engaged in some kind of diplomatic work. And Catherwood reports on the finding of Quirigua to Stevens, who records his narration in one of the books. The banana, the whole valley of the Montagua region, it's been turned into a banana plantation, except that the United Fruit Company spared, as part of a philanthropic gesture, spared the few square kilometers that the site of Quirigua occupies. But you can see the original wooded area. The whole valley was deforested. The wood, the fine hardwood was taken to Europe for fine furniture. In order to move the wood, they create a railroad. In order to feed the railroad workers, they begin to plant bananas to the point in which they realize that bananas do very well in that valley, and that is how the, you know, Banana Republic is born. Sorry. So this is what I see in Paradox. And I wanted to mention this to point you to the archives, which are actually mural texts, and I am plugging some of my websites where I have the chronological information on, for example, this website, Paradox, which is a series of websites with a lot of text where I put all the results of the research. And they include Che Guevara in Bolivia, the work I did on La Vorágine, the vortex, and the rubber fevers and the extermination of Witoto Indians in the Putumayo region, the role of Roger Casement, who is mentioned in the famous novel The Vortex, La Vorágine. And then another website that is a continuation of El Día Que Me Quieras, which is dedicated to the only woman that fought together with Che Guevara, and where I foreground the notion of photography as a war trophy, since all the participants in Guevara's campaign took photographs, and when they were captured, the photographs became part of a market that the Bolivian military started. This last work, Tanya, also incorporates a second film made after El Día, called Exhumación, which is an interview with a forensic anthropologist that finds Che Guevara's remains. And I mentioned that all the research work, which is about six filing cabinet drawers were donated to an organization called CEDINCI, which is in Buenos Aires. And I donated all the research, which was pre-Google research. It had to be done going to places and book and libraries and hemerotecas and newspaper files and all that. And I think my 20 minutes are up. And thank you so much. Thank you.
Buenas tardes. Good afternoon. Thank you very much to the Getty for inviting me here today, and to Rani and Robert and Sue for making all the arrangements. And it's an honor and a pleasure to follow that wonderful work by Leandro Katz. And there's a lot of overlap between what we're saying, and hopefully afterwards we can pull out many of these common themes. So wonderful work in terms of programming us, I think, together. So in this talk today, I focus on mnemonic spaces within the Americas, those places that resonate with meaning and signification out of the long and dynamic histories interaction with colonialism. While one could define all of the continent as having a kind of signification latent with memory, I'm particularly drawn to artistic production that thinks about settler occupation against curfew, the kind of histories of disappearance, the resonances with burial, and the questions of resistance. In short, I'm pulled to sites of violent design and refuse, or what Tijuana-based scholar Sayek Valencia has called gory capitalism, and what I'm calling here is memory's dystopia. I theorize, write with, and make a protagonist out of the landscapes of dystopia, those places, those regions that have really experienced a kind of disturbance by power in its excess. I do so to kind of denaturalize the relationship between land and embodiment. Moreover, I reframe W.J.T. Mitchell's famous questions, what do pictures want, and combine it with Eduardo Cohen's important inquiry, how do forests think, and ask instead, what does memory want, and what do landscapes remember? For this project, I take many clues from Walter Benjamin. Though Benjamin theorized historical memory out of the wreckage of modernity rather than colonialism, his concept of memory as reiteration and non-progressive is useful here. His 1940 thesis on the philosophy of history was Benjamin's last published essay and was written as he escaped Vichy France and the Gestapo in Spain before being forced without escape to commit suicide on the Spanish border town of Labou. Visiting the memorial site recently as a now quiet and beautiful place of witness, I followed the traces of Benjamin's last days, finding backdoor archives, listening to the echoing sound of a train pulling away from the station, and foraging in a graveyard in the pitch dark for his burial site. All of this enlivened for me the disaster that Benjamin faced and the question of what memory wants. Fascist Europe literally left no place for a Jewish intellectual to hide, except as a seaside final resting place beneath the earth. Benjamin's thesis is a devastating challenge to Marx's historical materialism by illustrating how its progressive narrative reduces history to a linear temporal frame. As is oft-cited, Benjamin uses Paul Klee's Angelus Novus, a painting he acquired in 1921 and that provided much philosophical inspiration to depict how the angel facing forward has its back turned toward the future, challenging the notion that history is composed of a sequence of events or past events. Indeed, in a number of places in the essay, Benjamin employs images and pictures as a way to describe history as ultimately ungraspable through narration. As he writes, quote, "To articulate the past historically does not mean to recognize it as it really was. It means to seize hold of a memory as it flashes as a moment of danger," end quote. Memory is a flash amidst danger, Benjamin intimates, is the announcement of the dystopic in the future past. Klee's angel views the rubble of history as instantly accumulative, rather than the inevitable march of time. Benjamin's layered image is precisely the understanding of memory or the mnemonic that I want to work with today, namely as a future-oriented articulation that is politically salient and relationally rich in its visual and sensual vibrating meaning. Unlike the binaries of memory as either obsessive on the one hand or memory as obliterative and amnesic on the other, I instead think about an image-based concept of memory whose temporality is situated in the past future, as Benjamin described it, and as many indigenous cultural forms invoke. For instance, Riet Delsing describes the Rapa Nui gesture of touching one's back while facing forward to signify the time of memory's future. Such an understanding of memory can invoke the possibility for liberation, or at least give an afterword to dystopia. So obviously, to substantiate the last statement, there's a lot of territory we must travel together today. The journey is really to put into motion a critical discourse that is both historical and image-based and non-reductive in its relationship to both time and space, so that my work works to reshape memory studies from a Latin American critical perspective. My effort here is to think outside of the usual representations of disappearance within studies of the hemisphere that highlight only the activism, say, of the Madres de los Desaparecidos in Argentina, the Mothers of the Disappeared, or that decontextualize the important work of border art in relation to feminicide in Juarez. While these are clearly consequential matters, my point is that a focus on signature social representations takes us away from a deeper understanding of how burial, the disappeared body, and violent histories of colonization are not an exceptional condition. What land knows and remembers cannot always be apprehended either through forensic science or through liberal human rights paradigms. I would argue further that knowledge and curatorial production has suffered from a kind of entrapment in relation to memory. On one pole of this binary, memory has been obsessive, an attempt to produce an archive that is replete with every detail of the past as a catalog for the living. Think, for instance, of Jorge Borges Funes, who does not have enough space to gather in his library all the details of his memory. The comment here by Borges is on the labyrinth of memory and the impossibility to contain the force of the past. On the other pole, I would situate the work of Andreas Hussein, who's contemplated memory in this way, but also a lot of the work that's been done on Latin America is within this kind of paradigm, that is, that memory is a privileged site of forgetting, a privileged site of erasure. Hussein, for instance, describes how in the face of traumatic events, collectives would rather undergo a shallow kind of process of amnesic forgetting than face the traumatic realities produced by episodic violence. So to address a kind of more flexible understanding of memory, I feel like we have to go beyond the conceptual language of memory studies and what it's used. Official memory, state memory, counter memory, alternative memory, visual memory, or even archival memory, to approximate something else, something more profound and heterogeneous about colonial violence. Namely, how does memory think? How does the land remember? So today I'm going to focus on three entry points into how memory landscapes ultimately force us to reckon with a recursive, non-progressive, and anti-redemptive understanding of historical consciousness, consciousness as relational and pushing back against the future. My first instance comes from South America, and I start this section with a memorial gesture. Pedro Lemebel was a great Chilean literary writer, poet, and performance artist, born into a working-class family on the outskirts of Santiago, and whose class consciousness fundamentally shaped the literary, poetic, and performative oeuvre that she carried out over the course of several decades. I use the pronoun she here, or ella, because the pronoun the author and performer often adhere to as a transgender subject living within and satirizing a vastly homo and transphobic society. For instance, at age 26, Lemebel was fired from his teaching post as a visual studies high school teacher in Santiago, presumably for his out trans appearance. In the wake of his recent passing on January 23rd of this year, there's no way to do justice to the impact La Mebel has had and continues to have on the cultural scene within Chile, in South America, in the broader Spanish-speaking world, and beyond. Despite the fact that La Mebel has been translated into more than 5 languages, she's still relatively unknown in the US, compared to, say, the best-selling novice Roberto Bolaño, but that's another story. During the 1980s and 1990s, La Mebel worked closely with his partner and collaborator Francisco de Casas in Las Yeguas del Apocalipsis, the Mares of the Apocalypse, a performance and video production duo. The duo represented what one blog site recently cited as a surprising turn for La Mebel's career. But the formation of Las Yeguas was anything but surprising, given the performance genealogies that passed through Enrique Lin and Alejandro Jodorowsky, who in the 1950s produced a series of happenings in Santiago. These were later replicated and expanded in their repatriation to Mexico City, and another incarnation refigured in Paris, in Paris. During the 1960s and early 1970s, there was a vibrant cultural scene that was politically left in Chile. The street was the site of massive popular celebrations that showed support for what felt like millions for a utopic moment of Salvador Allende's popular unity government. Then came the catastrophe of September 11, 1973, that ushered in neoliberalism and a new extractivist logic. This on-steroids mode of capitalism, combined with military authoritarianism, marked the death of both President Salvador Allende and the Unidad Popular's dream. Within the ashes of what was the world's first democratic experiment with socialism, an attempt at a more equitable distribution of land, copper, labor, and an incipient hopes of feminist and indigenous emergence, a dramatic escena avanzada, an avant-garde, appeared. Pinochet and his advisors quickly recognized the danger posed by what was dubbed a kind of subversive and anti-state art. The cultural scene was forced underground and was almost completely wiped out. Amidst the tens of tortured, more than 3,000 disappeared and hundreds of thousands forced into exile, dissident artistic production had to become flexible, agile, street-based, extreme, and of high visual and affective impact. This scene, named by Nellie Richard in her wonderful 1987 work, was critiqued as anti-populist, yet its radical significations functioned to remind a society in crisis of all that had been lost and what could still be found through imaginative acts. As Jodorowsky says about his work in the decades prior to dictatorship, the point of performance was to, quote, take the theater out of the theater, end quote. During dictatorship, Colectivo de Acciones del Arte, CADA, did something similar, which was to take art out of the museum. Briefly, Colectivo de Acciones del Arte was comprised of 4 members that included Raúl Zurita, Lottie Resenfeld, Juan Castillo, and Fernando Valses. What they produced together from 1971 to 1984, or 1985, depending on whether the performance La Viuda or The Widows included, was an important series of urban interventions that became foundational to the gestoral repertoire of Las Yeguas, and that's why I'm mentioning it. While No Más is the most famous of these works, much of the work produces a provisional archive of memory in risky alterations that anticipated military and police surveillance. Interestingly, CADA had the forethought to document these landscapes of interruption for the possibility of future viewings. Las Yeguas del Apocalipsis built upon these performative and visual environments. They did so not only by perforating the hard space of urban militarization, like CADA, but also by making an explosive visual critique of normative embodiment. Influenced by the actions of CADA, Las Yeguas was an antidote to the Christian morality and compulsory heterosexuality of a government in the midst of a gender rollback, especially about women's roles within the nuclear family. Las Yeguas' experimental aesthetics pushed the boundaries of normalcy, legitimacy, and morality that had been established by Pinochet's strict and legalized codes of conduct. You couldn't even wear miniskirts at the time. This slide of the duo disrobed on horseback is a still from the performance Yegua de Dos Pisos, Mirror of Two Levels, which took place on October 8, 1988 at the Art Faculty of the Public University of Chile. This was right after the plebiscite vote against Pinochet. As Francisco Aravena Solar explains about the performance, La Yegua's intent was to produce a disturbance and to create a shock that would, quote, leave the students catatonic and sin aliento, end quote, or without breath. Generating repulsion became its own act of public interventionism into the orderly. There are many ways to interpret this performance, and a dominant way has been to suggest the transvestite querying of the Spanish colonizer Pedro de Valdivia as a kind of reversal of the figure of colonial heroism. Yet to me, rather than merely a kind of reversal of the colonial model, the performance mocks the paradigms of civility and undoes them by rehearsing the unexpected, namely by riding nude on the back of a female horse. In a related analysis, I want to pause on the performance duo's name, the Mares of the Apocalypse. This refers to the queer and trans identification with a female horse that rides queerly through the urban landscape. The gesture is to break up masculine power, a queer overturning of the Christian notion of apocalypse, and a decentering of the human by taking on the wildness of the animal. In New Work, Jack Halberstam refers to the wild as naming a, quote, space of dissonance that we cover up or we turn away from in our quest for order, logic, and sequence, end quote. Entertaining this dissonant landscape, the mare wildly gallops through the aftermath of a apocalypse in the midst of a barren cultural landscape. The mare is a fecund symbol here of queer creativity. And this is a juxtaposition that Lemivel and Casa has beautifully conjured with their own collaboration. The second Las Yeguas performance I want to briefly speak about is The Conquest of the America. This performance took place on October 12, 1989, on el Día de la Raza in Latin America, a day that celebrates conquest rather than noting or memorializing indigenous genocide. As the duo walked across a map of Las Americas, a map that was sprinkled with a broken glass of Coca-Cola bottles, their bare feet were cut and their feet left bloodstains behind them. They danced the cueca sola, they danced alone, you might know the Sting song about this, bare-chested, inverting the traditionally criollo couple dance like relatives of the disappeared had before them, into a kind of call for action. And like other endurance art performers in the genre of what Jennifer Doyle has termed difficult art in work she published last year, the use of blood and masochism was a mediated way to elicit an emotive response from an audience. More specifically, Las Yeguas literally queered Eduardo Galeano's Las Venas Abiertas de America Latina, that was cited in an earlier film, The Open Veins of Latin America. This, of course, is the classic text of Latin America's historical relationship, first to the Spanish and Portuguese colonial powers, and then in relationship to US empire. The fact that two gay, biologically masculine, but often trans-drag performers enacted the spilling of blood offered an entirely new meaning to the extraction of the continent in the era of the AIDS crisis. Las Yeguas showed how embodiment matters in relation to mapping the memories of an AIDS apocalypse. La Yeguas remaps performance and visual histories to ask us how they serve the memories of a queer social landscape. We might read Lemivel and Gass's attention to the conditions of alternative sexualities as a form of the masochistic. Amber Musser has recently written on the racial and sexual meanings of masochism, asking us to think anew about how, quote, flesh means thinking about embodiment and how it articulates a particular relationship to embodiment, quote, unquote, that passes, she says, through the social. She suggests that, quote, while masochism is not always a space of subversion and exceptionalism, it can offer an important analytical space where difference may be revealed, end quote. The fleshy masochism of Las Yeguas' performance, then, is another way to imagine memory's enactment and its temporal disobedience. In this section, I want to turn from embodiment and enactment to nature, not as a pure romantic site of loss, but as a memory landscape in itself. Indeed, I recently learned from Eduardo Cohn that tropical forests have, for hundreds of years, been intertwined with indigenous planting and harvesting so that no landscape is an untouched site. Within the overwrought landscapes of what Aníbal Quijano refers to as, quote, the coloniality of power, end quote, nature has been cast, however, as ideal, pure, and vacant of indigenous peoples, a terra nullius, decidedly absent of creative re-renderings. Representations of land look very different when organized through the visuality of indigenous critique rather than the colonial gaze. In this section, I want to focus on Francisco Huichaqueo Perez's experimental video, Men Sed, Ni Pe Moi, a new form of indigenous critique that must be contended with as an important memory encounter. In Mapudungun, the term Ni Pe Moi refers to the 5-century-plus bad dream from which Mapuches and Huincas, or non-Mapuches, have not yet awoken from in the aftermath of the colonial rupture. Mapuche director Huichaqueo Perez visualizes this dystopic landscape that is the colonized southern territories of Chile and Argentina, a nightmare that stretches into the present day. Even though it's an easily accessible, and you can see it on Vimeo, it's not an easy film to view, and perhaps has precursors in the work of Juan Dávila, amongst others. But I have yet to understand all of these references, so I welcome you to read the longer chapter about the film when I'm done with it. In its formal elements, the experimental film is multidimensional. There's no other way to describe it. It incorporates documentary footage, animation, performance, still images, voiceover narrative, and footage of activist struggles from the 1970s until today. Huichaqueo Perez's film unsettles precisely because it questions normative temporality and disarticulates a sense of place, blurring the boundary between sleep and waking life in the space where much is lost and the director's own positionality as an urban half-mestizo, half-Mapuche subject, he himself identifies this way, is in constant flux. The film disorients the viewer with sharp, disconnected edits, and the immersive view is unclear while a jolting narrative voice calls from the past to haunt the visual text. As viewer, we move through a present-past nightmare that we too cannot awake from. Men Sed Ni Pe Moi opens with a colonial portrait of a bare-chested Mapuche young man who gazes directly into the camera. The image recalls a warrior figure that dates back to Lautaro's historic victory against the Spanish crown. Lautaro, perversely, is the subject of national literature and the figuration of what Charles Hale has termed the indio permitido, the civilized, whitened, and passable Indian that perpetuates racism for the majority native population. Lautaro is a complex figure for Mapuches and Huincas alike. Given that Republican literature and national emblems have recycled the image of the undefeated warrior as a symbol of great pride, such an image has different connotations in the present. Dozens of young Mapuches, mostly men and some women, are currently in prison in Santiago for their uprising. We don't hear about this much in the United States, but for their uprising against the state and against the privatization of their lands. Indeed, the theme of male indigenous activism is rendered throughout the film with figurations alternatively about rage, about arson, or burning down the pine plantations and animate how indigeneity is representationally imprisoned. In an early black and white scene, the camera tracks through rows and rows of pine with a strange echoing voiceover that sutures two historical periods of violence against indigenous peoples, the colonial and the neo-colonial. And they imprison my brothers, the cross, that curse, the fire that feeds all of our dead. You have the fear that is my brown conscience because your richness is my death. With the fear of the tree drying in the sun, we are interwoven with the past, steps that are marked by the ash, layered with ash. The elders die alone. Your blood cries, layered over blood, roble huacho, solitary laurel, extinguished by wind, pine, 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 pine. How the burning plain wind cries, how they count their millions. In this rattling poem, Huichaqueo Perez conjures the histories of anti-colonialism, connects them to the present day uprising by Mapuche peoples against the monocultural forest plantations that were the result of neoliberal policies. As the camera moves through the pine forest at the ground level, the view is of the now ubiquitous pine trees, the foreign species that replaced the Bewen, whose flower from its seeds provided a main staple of local diets for centuries. As the camera pushes quickly through the neatly lined forest, the voiceover soundtrack is loud and startling, invoking the ancestral realm and the ontological space between the visible and the immaterial with its echoing hollowness. The soundtrack becomes itself the space of memory, of land and the nearly extinct Bewen tree. And he goes on to talk about the pinos, the eucalyptos, a cry for an extinguishing tree, which at Geo Perez returns us to the scene of ecology, not as melancholic loss and separation, but instead to render how capitalist valuation produces what Patrick Wolf has called, quote, the elimination of the native, end quote. And that Patrick Wolf article, I'd highly recommend. It's very easy to get on the internet, and it circulates a lot in indigenous communities worldwide now. In a montage that follows, a Mapuche elder points to the land and sky, and echoing in the background is a resounding cry of the pino, pino, pino. The jarring sequence ends with a shot in the city of a young woman, a Machi figure, that stands in a warrior position with a laurel branch in her teeth, in contrast to the por la razón o la fuerza, by reason or strength, the governmental emblem of the republic in the next scene. For Huichaqueo Perez, the dream is recurrent, and it is about a visit to hear from a female Machi about his own individual pathway as an experimental filmmaker, as much as it is an effort to render multinational settler occupation in the South. The land remembers the Arauco struggle, the dam struggle of the 1990s, the fight over Maule River further back, the reducciones period, or the reservation and settlement period, and the new iterative use of the terrorist clause in the Constitution that has been used to criminalize Mapuche peoples. There's much to unpack in the film and a lot to navigate in terms of histories of settler colonialism and the colonial gaze, such as a call for the end of Eurocentrism and the romantic view as embodied by the floating Ophelia figure. Ultimately, Huichaqueo Perez insists that the native figure will not disappear. The native figure is not just a figment of an archaeological past, or in the context of slow genocide, or with extractivist replacement. Instead, landscape returns the memory of colonial violence back again. And in the scars of the harvested pines, Mapuche families replant and make sustenance to imagine a more livable future. So in order to talk about this last piece in my exploration of the aesthetics of dystopia, memory, and landscape, I have to start further back in time to the pre-Columbian figure of Coatlicue, the figure that Jean Franco argues has, quote, garnered endless speculation far more than any other single pre-Columbian artifact, end quote. While there have been countless interpretations of Coatlicue that many of you may know, and everyone from Manuel Gamio to Octavio Paz has written about the statue's relationship to the Mexican nation, I'm interested instead in the history of Coatlicue's burial as a memory symbolic for the fosa común, or the common grave in Latin America. Be it Mayan Guatemala, dissident Argentina, El Salvador's El Mazote massacre, and currently as a mnemonic index of the 43 disappearances in Ayotzinapa. Coatlicue, as Franco tells us, was buried in the vicinity of the temple complex, constructed after the Aztecs had consolidated their hold over the Valley of Mexico and far-flung provinces a century before the Spanish conquest. In 1790, the statue was accidentally found in the Plaza Mayor of Mexico City when workers were constructing an underground aqueduct, and she was transferred to be studied and then reburied. As Ana de León put it, the professors did not want Mexican youth to be, quote unquote, exposed to such a horrible sight, and there's a lot of lore about the kind of ugliness of the figure. Coatlicue was buried and unburied at least five or six times, if not more, alternatively by clerics, by government officials, by institutions of power. But what I want to note here today through her figure is that the history of burial and the war over representation both precedes and helps establish the modern nation state. Burial is a way to do away with forms of knowledge and forms of representation that do not sit easily with power. In her dissertation on decolonial aesthetics, Jennifer Reynolds Kay connects the figure of Guatlique and her story to other aesthetic performances of burial, namely Keith Arnett's self-burial in 1969 and Robert Smithson's partially burned woodshed in 1970. By locating the Earth Goddess's unearthing and reburial in several cyclical moments, Reynolds Kay points to the possibility of burial as his own site of artistic erasure. However, rather than erasure, Guatlique's story is closer to me to Regina Galindo's work, Earth. For its multiple meanings, a potentially auto-destructively rendering of the female body as its own kind of memory landscape, and a performative image that leaves a deep and lasting impression about how machines devour. The collective burials I refer to both references history of representation of landscape within a kind of Western aesthetics, but also fall uneasily outside of them. For instance, Rosana Regillo describes Ayotzinapa as a place of a death machine run amok and the indication of a bulimic society that consumes its youth only to vomit them back up, its own kind of self-burial. And this takes place, she states, quote, in the form of graves, as maquilas and precarious jobs, where the poverty rate in Mexico is 50%, end quote. In a recent forum at NYU that we organized called When Governments Kill Their Students, Regillo asked, how is it possible to intervene in a social fabric that is capable of producing these chewed up bodies, bodies crushed by the machine? What kind of counter machine do we need to make an effective intervention? To address her own pressing questions, she responded in a now familiar and important refrain for Regillo that, quote, we have to take both las calles y las redes, take the streets and the virtual network, and so much more. She reminds us that the death of 43 students, their burial, potential death in Ayotzinapa, is a condensation of thousands upon thousands of death in Mexico. And the point is to, one, keep the social movement alive, two, intervene in the information war with new stories, and three, intervene in the dominant image culture by putting new and relevant images into the public sphere. And this is precisely what I'm calling for, following Regillo, the need for these new kind of elaborated images in the public sphere and in our museums. Regillo describes how the mnemonic image of the face of Julio Cesar Mondragon, for instance, was given back by society after he was literally splayed by the state. I would extend Regillo's analysis to suggest that this is precisely the past-future orientation of Benjamin's angel, where the burial of the image must be unearthed to imagine a different future. Certainly, truth commissions have not functioned with this concept of temporality and memory, since they are finite and contained, controlled narratives of a violence that want to move on to a time of social peace. What memory wants of us and what the land knows is how the thousands of bodies continue to create a counter machine through image, through the street and the network, through our own control of images. This is what enlivens the past future. So let me just say, by way of closing, that this talk was not an attempt at equivalences of cases. It's not an attempt to look at kind of violence as an equivalent or a predilection to resolve or to say that these are the most prescient images and metaphors of making memory. Instead, through each site, my hope is to foreground visual and sensual experimentation that intersects with how scholars, activists, and curators make new understandings out of histories of representation. We raise the possibility of an ethically informed imagination. As the heterogeneous work of Pacific Standard Time moves to engage with the histories of the Americas from the location of the US, and we could argue whether we're in the Americas now, in Latin America, we must do so with increasing representational dexterity, with increasing depth. So my own contribution here is to nuance how we might engage memory and how memory itself feels us. Thank you. Well, thank you both so much for such interesting and just different presentations and just different ways of thinking about the ideas of just even blurring the ideas of archive and memory. And, you know, so many of the cases that you cite link archival materials and official histories to these marginal experiences that are almost buried in the landscape. And I guess one of my first questions for you is, you know, the idea of you're being drawn, can you explain why you are drawn to these micro histories and, you know, can you talk a little bit about why you're drawn to these micro histories and what kind of things, what are these, some of these virtues and what kind of things can be learned from these examples and these unpacking?
A little.
Well, I attempted somehow through the images to give an idea of how sort of things sort of took shape, and they're, you know, trying to find the original motivation. This is actually a question that one asks oneself. You know, it's like it's within your personal history, your travels and discoveries and all that. I sort of was able to trace my original impulse, you know, and I felt as I was moving forward, I felt that there were, I still feel that there are details that still need further investigation. So the idea of the micro historical detail attracted me constantly, and one leads to the other, and you feel, in a way, you feel that you find those things, and in a way they become a kind of debt that you have to somehow...
A kind of debt.
Yes. That you have to somehow address, you know. But my concern, however, is right now and after listening to Macarena's delivery and the way that she has made several turns in the history of art and performance, pointing to very specific creators, events, conditions, etc. My concern goes back to the idea of universality versus regionality, because I think that only recently, and thanks to many of the attempts that had been made by institutions such as the Getty, we are able to learn about these very fragmented expressions of crisis and libertarian concerns, etc. How my concern is how regional they are, and I'm sure that you have heard about the conceptualismos del sur and Anna Longoni's work, how there was this extraordinary attempt to bring movements that had taken place in the Americas, not in the 60s, but in the 70s, that had 70s and 80s, which had been kind of ignored, such as, for example, discovering Las Yeguas del Apocalipsis and knowing about the recent events, the death of one of the members. And my question is if you are in touch with Pancho Casas and if you sure know what is going on with that whole movement.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's...
I think my work is not so much about microhistories, actually. I think I'm more concerned with broader kind of connections and lateral connections between genealogies of coloniality, to put it that way. And I've been really influenced by decolonial thought and read a lot of decolonial thought that comes from the Americas. And there is, I feel, in a kind of US context of museums, et cetera, sometimes a kind of anti-intellectual bias against thinking about theory itself as a kind of creative practice. But that, in the Americas, it's not. These things are not split, right? There's a kind of real connection between histories of activism, explanations through theorizations, and I see my own work as a kind of creative practice as well. And so I think part of it for me has always been being formed as a kind of cultural sociologist, a thinker, activist within the United States in relationship to Latinidad and what that means to represent Latin America in this space, right, embodied within the United States, and to do that ethically. Mm-hmm. And it's a complicated thing because so much of the representational work, as we know, falls into these traps that I was trying to kind of elaborate
yes.
upon.
Right.
And your work, I think, is so wonderful in that it's always marking U.S. empire. Very small ways, but it does it, right? I mean, not so small. Bananas are a huge emblem, right, of empire. But I feel like that kind of focus and intent is really there, and it allows for the opening up of a kind of critique. I'm surprised by the fact that Lemavel's death didn't invoke more response in the U.S., right? I feel like his incredible production hasn't circulated here, and I don't really understand why. I think it's a question mark.
Really?
Why hasn't it, you know, here?
True.
I think he would, you know, there's a lot of images, you can look them up on the internet. He flips off the camera all the time. You know, his kind of fuck you gesture is always
right.
there, his rebel, his provocateur. And I think he'd say, you know, to the Chilean nation state now, who's taken him up as this grand cause,
right.
you never gave me any prizes, right? You didn't consider my work, so why kind of posthumously?
Yeah, no.
yeah
yes,
why
no.
now? So those are the kinds of questions I think I'm interested in,
mm-hmm.
in about the kind of circulation within context of social injustice.
Yeah. But it's interesting that your association with Cuatlicue, perhaps you can explain a little more about that because it's so charged.
Yeah, it's charged. I mean, I think it is an image that has been seen as ugly, maybe in comparison to some of the images that you've talked about, but there's a kind of deity and the earth goddess figure. And to me, the image I showed is very different in the juxtaposition to the image you showed of a kind of vibrant object, right? That is this pre-Columbian archaeological object. And I think you talked about those images, objects with a lot more sacred kind of quality than I did in the Cuatlicue discussion, right? But again, my focus was on power and the circulations of power, and yours was, I think, maybe more interesting on kind of, you know, vibrant, what Jane Bennett calls vibrant matter, right? The vibrant object, the non-human object,
mm-hmm.
and how it enlivens something.
Mm-hmm.
So I have to think more, and I think I have to deepen my analysis around it, and I think given your film, it helps me open it up a little bit. Yeah? I don't know if you want to say something about
well,
that.
There is always... For me, in the Catherwood project, Copan was the last. And it was the last because I had a kind of rejection, aesthetic rejection. I think that Copan and therefore Quiriguá are like an acquired taste, like you have to cultivate it, like the opera, you know, when you first see it. When you first see Copan's sculptures, you say, oh, they're just too strong, they're too grotesque, they're too scary looking, you know? And then you begin to develop an eye. It's like looking at new art, you know? When you look at new art, it looks ugly, and then somehow it sort of begins to penetrate your consciousness, you know? It's like, that happened to me with Copan, which I think is one of the most beautiful sides in terms of, you know, the quality of the sculpture, the expressiveness, the baroqueness of Mayan hieroglyphic markings and ornamentation, and you know, so it, you know, I would look at the Quadlique and say, God, it's so loaded of significance, you know, it's so extraordinary that the pleasure, I think, of admiring those pre-Columbian works has to do more with your desire to interpret, and your desire not necessarily to interpret it rationally, you know, but to interpret it visually, you know, it's like so. But I was very pleased with the fact that you jumped from the Jaguars del Apocalypse to the more contemporary events, and that you skipped the notion of regional conflicts, you know, that somehow it all becomes united by your text. So that was very good.
Thank you.
Should we open it up to questions in the audience? We have a few minutes for discussion. There's, I would just wait to ask your question until someone with the microphone arrives.
You began by evoking Portbou, and I'm curious, one, I'm assuming you know that Portbou is one of a series of sites on a trail through that part of Catalonia. They're all called sites of memory, yes? Also, of course, that Benjamin, well, simple word here, but lost his suitcase with his life's work on his way to Portbou. Auguste Santelli, the photographer, did the opposite. He left Portbou with his file of suitcases, the photographs that could have identified the people who were in the resistance against Franco, found them 45 years later. He too is on that site of memory. My point really is to ask two questions. One is, I personally feel that the issues of memory are, that there's a poetics of memory that are equally important to the, and not separate from political theorizing. And I'd be curious to hear, you both seem to be kind of hinting at it, but not really. And the other is, to Leandro's point about the universality of this, the connections that either of you may feel to what is happening now in Spain, the internment or lack of internment of the bones from the Franco years, the large global questions that tie all of this together.
Well, I mean, I think the reason I started with Benjamin, obviously, because he's such a powerful, profound intellectual, and I'm really enjoying reading a biography about him that was published last year. And it's clarifying for me the kind of histories of dissident intellectualism that I think I'm trying to understand how those circuits have traveled, you know, during modernity and in crisis and fascism in Europe, but also as a way to kind of unthink Europe from within in that moment, right? So there's a way for me that America scholarship kind of links up with a kind of Benjaminian dialectic or critique in really, really interesting ways that I'm still writing out and trying to understand. But what's so interesting is that a lot of these kind of memory circuits are actually really well marked now. In Chile, you can go, you can visit the General Cemetery, have any of you been there? And you can go and see Salvador Allende's tomb, you can go and see where Victor Jara was buried. There are all these kind of circuits of memory. You can go to the burial sites of Patio 29 and where the NN were disappeared, you know, in the General Cemetery. You can go to Villa Grimaldi, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and it proliferates, and there's a kind of memory tourism and an uncriticality around representation sometimes in those tourist spaces, which why I was really interested when you kind of peopled, right, those spaces. That place in Port Labou is done really beautifully, right? It's a different kind of memory tourism. That is, you have to really search out the sites and go around. Maybe there's more to it, but for me it was a kind of uncovering in a way, and you have to know something to get to the next piece. And I think I'm really interested in that poetic aspect of a journey, right, of uncovering, rather than it all kind of just being prepackaged and ready for you. I think that's the analogy I would make there. As far as the kind of question of Spain, I mean, that's a much longer, complicated discussion, right, of the ways in which the Franco dictatorship and authoritarianism and that kind of memories unearthing there are just kind of aesthetically opening up in really, really interesting ways in the last, I'd say, 5 years. I gave a lecture there, I think, 7 years ago, and it was through Chile that a lot of scholars were beginning, and through the work in Argentina, to kind of do and think about their own case. And, I mean, to me, it's really interesting that it's taken so long, right? There's so much more to say about that, but I want to let you be able to respond, Leandro.
I lost track of the question. I lost track of the second part of the question, which was...
about
it
was global... More about,
right, and the political implications of archival investigation, and you kind of riding that
Well,
line.
you always wish you could... affect the present, you know, or you could do something about, you know, that you could somehow do something about now. And the frustration is that, you know, it's like I work with the ancient past and perhaps with the less ancient past, but it seems to me that by the time you try to filter information, which bombards us every day with horrible things, you know, by the time you try to absorb it. Anyway, I'm not a news person. I don't rely on information because information seems to be disposable. And so it takes me a long time for me to process something to the point in which I can turn it into something that I could call a little more lasting, and that one may call, I don't know, art, perhaps. So I'm not sure I can respond to your question in a reasonable way. I wish I could.
Well, you know, maybe given the kind of inseparability of the past and the present, we could think about the roles of the curator in reconceptualizing these histories.
We hope that, yes. Hopefully, yes, of course, yes.
Well, I think, you know, I wanted to ask you a question kind of that relates, and that is the first film, Paradox, reminded me a lot of Machilopolis. I don't know if people have seen that film or if you've seen that film.
No.
It's by directors Vicky Funari and Sergio de la Torre, and it talks, you know, it visualizes the maquila spaces and women doing performative, repetitive acts together, right, in choreographies that are about their kind of maquila, right, work. And I guess I wanted to ask, I was so intrigued and curious about how you actually got access to those spaces, because it didn't seem that people thought you were a voyeur or thought that the camera was obstructive. They really seemed to interact with the camera in interesting ways, and the camera does a lot of work, I think, to historicize.
Well, you develop a kind of invisibility or a friendly visibility, mm-hmm, you know, but it was a lot of work. It was probably one of the happiest films I ever made, because I made it all by myself. I didn't have to tell it anything to anyone, and I did everything, you know, the sound, they get the permits, they, you know, drive back and forth between Guatemala and Quiriguá, back and forth to get Bandegua to allow me to get in, and, you know, that kind of thing, and then getting in, followed by, you know, watchmen and, you know, sort of like all the overseers, mm-hmm, you know, so you had to be very discreet. You couldn't put anyone on the spot. I didn't want to do interviews. And I was actually coming from escaping Christmas in New York City, trying to get away from, you know, all the Christmas carols and all the shopping sort of fevers and all that, and decided to go to, you know, Guatemala and Honduras to make this film all by myself with all the equipment. I said, I'll do it. And right before leaving, I was listening to NPR, and I heard Spiritual by Marian Anderson. I recall vaguely it was called something like Our Lord Died in the Cross and Never Mumble a Single Word or something like that. It goes like, it's very, very moving. It got me completely. And it goes, not a word, not a word, not a word. And I said, okay, I'm going to go do this film, and I'm not going to ask a single question, not a word. Make a film where nothing is said. Everything is said with images, with sounds, you know. And it was I think it was luck, you know. The film came out well, and I, you know, had no difficulty moving through the workers, and I, you know, I did the whole interior scene in practically 20 minutes, and then all the exteriors, I took my time. It was a real treat to sit in front of the dragon with the camera all by myself and just be there.
It was also especially moving to see the portraits of some of the people and the workers, and I mean, the soundtrack itself, I mean, you say, you know, that there was no sound, you know, but the soundtrack itself really...
It's a character,
yes. It really takes a very monumental position, and the juxtaposition between these industrial machines and then these, you know, natural sounds of crickets and bugs and cars driving by.
And also the division between the, you know, the factory, the exploited, and the displays, the people that cannot be exploited, and so they are set aside, and so you see the people by the roads selling a parrot or an iguana or some overripe bananas. And that was like, for me, that was important, that relationship with the people that were outside the Bandegua station, you know, the plant, the harvesting plant, you know. That was I was very, very impressed by that, the displays, what Jim Franco calls the garbage, you know, the garbage, the human garbage produced by globalization. And
well, I mean, yes and no. I feel like you humanized, right,
yes,
the workers in a lot of ways, but I think it does raise a question of Mayan-ness. And the question of what does Mayan mean in the film, right? And I don't know, I haven't sorted it out. I actually would love to see it again and think it through, right? Because you're working with a lot of different time frames and a lot of different modes of production and the kind of pre-Columbian and the objects and the factory. And I think the way that the camera moves in those spaces, and it is begging the question of what does Mayan-ness mean now, right? In that landscape. And
well,
again, I don't
but
know the response.
There's something very interesting that Jesse Lerner has done, and I think he may be one of the few people that understands the camera movements in the round tablet at the end. When I go from the center, which is this voracious looking bird, and then I go and point to a hand, and then I go, I point to another hand, and then to a foot, and then to another foot. And Jesse has written about the quarter warrior that is represented in that tablet. It seems to be a warrior that is being chopped to pieces and sent into all four cardinal points, you know. And in a way, for me, that was a way of getting out the romanticizing the possible romanticizing of the past and the present, yeah. You know.
Mm-hmm. Do we have another question? Sally?
Yeah, this is for Leandro Katz.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank both of you and the whole afternoon. It was really provocative and stimulating. But you used the word a few minutes ago to be discreet. And I want
the word what?
Discreet or discretion. And yeah. It seems to me that you're in your work, and I don't know enough of it to really, I'm treading lightly here, that you move between discretion and indiscretion. But I wonder if this is a frequent oscillation, meaning in El Dia, the photographer you pay homage to, it is very clear that he sees his role as one of discretion, of not being too present, of not wanting to interfere too much and to overly orchestrate. And yet, at the same time, this is a film in which you're clearly orchestrating the indigenous people with a ceremony and the red banner and the huge red, almost crystal-like, long red banner, textile, whatever. And so I wondered, are you both paying homage to this photographer from the 60s as you also pay homage to the past, but also suggesting something else needs to be done now that is more present, more directly choreographed and interventionist, or if it's a movement back and forth?
Well, I use the slash symbol, you know, slash. In many works, I've used it in memory slash landscape slash memory, meaning and or this possibility. And the intention in doing the forward slash, we didn't really come out as a forward, but a backward slash, in the field was to set up that kind of ambiguity, you know, in cutting the field with a red banner. Now, in terms of discretion, indiscretion, I mean, that is a very careful balance that one has to take. I asked Patricio Guzman, I asked in one gathering such as this one, I was asking for advice. I was actually in a situation in Honduras, in the Honduras-Guatemalan border, in which I could have gone into not very representative and very work camps. I mean, there's a section in the border section that where you see, they're almost like concentration camps. The site where I was allowed to work was a photo opportunity site. If I could have gone into the sites that were beyond the press and all that, I would have seen something else. But then the question became, if I interview someone, I know that they are going to be in trouble. Mm. They see me pointing a camera or a microphone. So the question that I asked Patricio is, what would you do if you have an interviewee that, and you know that that person may be in trouble for just answering something, what would you do? And his reply was not of my satisfaction. I said I would ask the person whether he or she wants to risk this and become responsible for what they do. That was not really what I would have done. In other words, in terms of discretion, indiscretion, I mean, I would never put someone on camera knowing that that person may run the risk of being beaten or killed or fired or whatever. I don't know if that answers your question, in a way.
I mean, Patricio Guzman, that's an interesting example, because in La Batalla de Chile, right, his cameraman, he put him in such danger that he filmed his own death during the golpe militar.
Well, so, it was not...
I mean, it's not his...
It was not Patricio's...
Yeah, but there's a different kind
doing
of...
Doing it was... Right, it was... a team of cameramen, a cameraman was killed, yes, right. And you can see him dying, because you can see the military man aiming at him and shooting him, and the camera falls. You know, it's terrifying, terrifying moment, yeah.
Do we have any other questions?
Thank you for both of you for your presentations, and Leandro for your films. It's good to see you again. Macarena, your analysis of Ayotzinapa, how you connected the present day violence with the burial of the pre-Columbian figure, reminded me a lot of Octavio Paz's analysis of the 1968 massacre in Mexico City, where he said it was sort of like a reproduction of the ancient Aztec sacrifices. And so my question for both of you would be, in your travels and in your research further south than Mexico, how much does pre-Columbian history or mythology figure into interpretations of contemporary state violence? In Mexico, it's very common, it seems, thanks to Octavio Paz and to an analysis like yours, but I wonder how much that figures into other countries further south. Mm-hmm.
What an interesting question. I mean, I think you're right to hone in on the way in which Mexico is exceptional to a certain degree in incorporating a kind of pre-Columbian figuration as part of its national literary project, but then you could think of Peru as also, right, with the Incan, discussions. I mean, part of the book I'm writing now is really looking at, in one chapter, the kinds of ways in which the Incan figure has been used as a kind of cover-up for all kinds of discussions around violence and state violence during Fujimori period and afterwards, and the kind of way in which a lot of the spiritual tourism, I'm calling it, or mystical tourism, is another form of extraction of the native, precisely because these ayahuasca tours are ways of kind of going and connecting to some kind of pre-Incan mystical past, right, sometimes excludes the possibility for a more in-depth look at the kind of ways in which a lot of those, there was indigenous genocide, right, during the Fujimori years. So, you know, in cultural critical magazines and the work of Nellie Richard and some of the work that circulates in South America, certainly that kind of discourse and discussion's alive, but it's not a part of the national imaginary, I think, in the way that in Mexico it is. And in the Chilean case, this kind of Mapuche visibility, which is similar to the kind of some of the struggles around, you know, Zapatismo and the autonomous communities, the post-1992 period, right? It's radically disturbing how little it kind of enters into a kind of public debate, and the ways in which racism and indigenous racism and continues to be so present and so enlivened. So, I mean, I think part of my work is also to make those connections, precisely as you say. But in the case of Mapuches, right, there's not these kind of big artifacts, and there's not these big mystical pasts, so figures like Lautaro become really central, these resistant warrior figures of a kind of mythologies, other kinds of historical mythologies. But they're used by the nation state in ways that I think continue to replicate that violence and need to be disidentified from the nation state in those ways. So thanks for the question.
Well, you see, I'm always a little cautious with this whole idea of landscape and citizenship. I mean, in terms of landscape and the definition of identity. And I wonder to what extent, you know, that is a fiction, an imposed fiction, an official story fiction, you know, it's as if we were defining our identity by whatever illustrates our currency bills. You know, it's like whether anyone here in this room feels American because of Mount Rushmore, or you know, or any landscape that can define you as an American. You know, it's like in a way I am suspect of that notion of identity, and at the same time, I realize and I accept that the fact that some regions in the Americas have a stronger historical identity that cannot be ignored, such as in the case of Mexico or Peru. But I would rather think in terms of, I don't know, how Bolivian identity is changing right now. Or I wonder how Ecuadorian identity is changing because they have dollar bills instead of Ecuadorian pesos, you know. It's like, so in a way, I mean, I am a little, you know, sort of like, I take it a little bit more humorously. I don't, you know, I'm not really that involved in that whole process of identity. I think the notion of personal experience, I think in a way identity is a sort of fiction that one constructs, each individual, and you know, there are all these elements we can gather from, but in a way I think it's a very personal, you know, sort of experience. I wish it was more so than something imposed by the notion of a state, you know, for example.
I think that actually might be a good moment to bring the conversation
there. There
is
a question raised with great enthusiasm.
Oh, well, Berenice, of course. And
thank you so.
Who? Oh, thank you so much for your presentation, the two of you. I have a long-standing conversation with Leandro's work, and it was a delight discovering your work, Macarena. I'm going to actually not ask you questions about your presentation, but my understanding is that this is a pre-event for a series of events that are being organized, and I wanted to thank Rani for being the instigator of this. And I think we are at a crucial moment when the question of representation and cultural activism about Latin America here now in the landscape of Los Angeles is crucial, and actually I have accepted to be a little bit of a spy for my institution to report about what can we do, how can we involve our students, the kind of events that we can organize, the kind of screenings, the kind of panel discussions. And so I'm wondering if you guys have some ideas and feedback about how we can make this Pacific Standard Time a really, really successful series of intervention. And I'm talking about not only exhibitions, but involving new categories of people, young people, students, workers, and so forth.
Is that to us? Could
either of you? Well, I think that the purpose of gatherings such as this are precisely to suggest, you know, possible directions, but you see, I'm not in control here.
I mean, I think, Berenice, there's so many ways and so many levels to answer your question.
Right.
You know, on the most basic level, the idea, you know, you look at the list of proposed exhibitions, they're very diverse. They cover a very wide range of time periods, geographical areas. And I think that often, you know, the way Macarena had discussed, that there are these layers of history, and so little is known here, and how these histories get presented to us in the States, and that the idea of being able to unpack these and look at them across exhibitions, and not only exhibitions, but really with the very rich series of performances, film screenings, discussions, all of these types of events over a period of time can kind of give us a very potent immersion I know for me personally, you know, the project that I'm working on is a film-oriented one, and I feel like just in terms of these first stages of research, there's so many micro histories that have happened that I am totally unaware of, and that, you know, putting these pieces together are just very, very, you know, well, hopefully result in a series of programs in 2017 that will interact with all these exhibitions and kind of make them, you know, to kind of enliven them and kind of, and that's... I think there'll be a curriculum that will be developed, that will be available to students, just as they did for the first iteration of Pacific Standard Time. I think also to encourage the students to attend as many exhibitions as possible, to attend the screenings and discussions. I mean, I think if the first Pacific Standard Time is any example, that really, you know, we're still continuing to see the residual effects of that. And this, I think, is going to be much more powerful. So.
Yeah, I guess I would just add one thing very concretely. I mean, from my participation so far in a number of events, I think there's a really wide and beautiful range of projects and intentions and curatorial possibilities. Something that I've seen fall out, but I think it's going to be there in a couple of the exhibits, which I think is great, and I think it's just because of regionality in some ways, is the Caribbean and the representations of a kind of Black presence in the Americas and the kind of connections between those histories and thinking about decoloniality in relationship to those struggles. And then the other thing is the incredible location that is LA for LA and Chicanos here and Latinidad here, right? And how bringing in Latino students, say, or different generations of people, I think you're suggesting other constituencies, working class folks, et cetera, and to think about kind of programming that would do that more, because you certainly see those students in the exhibits, right? And then how to kind of make the connections in these spaces as well in terms of pedagogies of, you know, thinking together about Latinidad in that way. So anyways, but that's a great question, and I think there's more to kind of pursue there.
Mm-hmm. But also mercados, billboards, to draw people in, to make it more Latino, to remind everyone who lives here that this LA was once part of greater LA, Latin America, and was where, you know, it was Hispanic, and Spanish was the dominant language, and to, in some ways, maybe impose as a reminder that on the physical presence, be it, I mean, I still think billboards and open air markets and swap meets and other things, yeah, as well as important conventional museum and gallery spaces.
Yeah, I think there's been a lot of thought in thinking about how ways to do that.
Dialogue.
I'm so glad you talked about the Black presence in Latino experience. Right now, there is the Pan-African Film Festival, which is taking place in Crenshaw. And I've seen a number of films that involved issues about the Caribbean experience. Or, for example, I saw a great movie about the transgender Black Latino experience. And this is an event which is geared to the community. I think there's about 10% of non-African American or African people in this event. We should establish a passage. And so this is what was, and thank you so much, because I don't follow this when I asked that question, but this is just exactly what I somewhat subconsciously had in mind.
Okay, one final question.
No, just a question. I just want to plug in reaction to the question that was asked. Back there, I think it's extremely important to engage the audiences and students and diverse groups of people with the artists. there is something really rich when that happens, just based on experiences of, you know, working in at Museo del Barrio and at different museums here in LA with young people and different audiences. The experience that the audiences have when they have a chance to speak, that's right, and to hear the artist share his or her experience, it's truly wonderful. I mean, something really important happens there. There is that kind of connectivity that opens up this, you know, the issues of identity and how we identify and in ourselves with place, with time and culture. That I think that's really critical. In fact, I mean, we don't have much time here, but what triggered me, what made me really interested in, you know, when you said you began your presentation, Leandro, you said something about the archaeology of myself. And I would really like you to elaborate on that. And again, I mean, going back to issues of identity, I'm not sure if you grew up in Argentina, if you grew up, if it mattered to you that, you know, you've been into so many places, so it's really difficult to speak about identity connected to one place, obviously. But I was just really triggered by that. I wanted to understand, what do you mean when you say it's archaeology of yourself?
Should I respond?
Sure, we have that's time? It's a very long question.
It's a long question.
I mean, very long answer, but maybe you can give a very brief response,
yes,
and we can continue
sure.
the
conversation. No, yes, I'm Argentine. I travel for many, many years through all the Americas. I feel very, very American in the biggest sense. I have lived in New York for 40 years. I live in Argentina now. I have lived in Mexico, in Peru, in Guatemala, in Honduras, in Colombia, in Bolivia. Mm. Anyway, I have moved around a lot. And regarding the archaeology of myself, it has to do with being able to reconstruct, you know, looking at photographic archives, you know, looking at film archives, re-editing films, looking at an enormous collection of negatives and slides that I am able to classify and archive right now, and realizing the connections between all the projects and how they have developed. And so in that sense, I was talking ironically about the archaeology of myself, mm-hmm. if that answers your mm-hmm. question briefly.
Well, I would just like
everyone.
To take a moment to thank you both so
thank
much.
You, Ronnie.
I also wanted to acknowledge our graduate intern, Robert Kett, whose work has really been influential.
And
thank
work.
You all for staying and join us outside for a coffee and discussion.